You've coined something called the Great Filter. What is the Great Filter, and where are the aliens?
We live in this vast universe. It goes on and on and on. And we're alive, and we have a history of life. Life seems to have started somewhere in our past near here, developed into us, and we look to our future and go, we should become big. We should become powerful. We should leave this planet, even the solar system, and we could remake stars, remake the galaxies. We have this great potential as a future. And we look out in the universe and we think, well, we can't be the only ones. There must have been other places that didn't have life, then created life and created us and then went on to this big future. But where are they? That is, we don't see much of this big future in the universe. So that creates this question, where are the aliens? Fermi's question, where is everybody? So I reframed this question a different way. I said, okay, well, there's this process starting from simple dead matter, going through simple life, advanced life like us, even more advanced life that could be visible in the universe. There's a physical process by which things start at one end and get to the other end of that chain. And at the end of that chain, there's almost nothing. The universe seems to have almost nothing out there that has reached this end that we think is a plausible end for us. And so that means it's really hard to go along this path. And we can think of how that's hard as a filter. There are places where many things start and they don't all reach the end. Some things knock them off the path. So the great filter is the sum total of all these obstacles, from starting from simple dead matter to becoming the visible, expanding life that you could see from a long way away, which we don't see.
Examples of these filters, examples of these obstacles.
Right, so for example, your planet could just never evolve life in the first place. Or it could never evolve sexual selection, or could never evolve multicellular creatures, right? Or never involve social intelligence and brains. These are all things that might never have happened. And so the question is, how hard was it to go from each step to the next step? And that difficulty would be the filter. You could think of it as, if it happened at one moment, what's the chances? Did it have to go down a really lucky path? And if it had gone down other paths, that would have been just a dead end. It never could have gotten at it. Or is it like a slow trying process? I keep having to try billions of possibilities and eventually gets to the one that works.
And you're referring to globally catastrophic for the civilization or for the life form. So that is to say, if there are five parallel life forms evolving and you slice away two, or some catastrophe happens that only affects two out of the five, these three continue. You don't consider that a filter?
It wouldn't so much be a problem if the others could go ahead. But if, say, there's different ways of configuring life, and if one succeeds, it blocks all the others, well, that could be a filter, because maybe you needed to go one of the other paths and you couldn't have got here except for that. So the thing is to notice, it might be hard to get to where we are, and it might be hard to get from here to where we hope to be. So the filter is whatever's making this hard. So I just thought of restating the question, where is everybody, as how big is the filter? And in particular, how much have we passed? Because if we're almost through the filter, then maybe it'll be pretty easy for us to go out there and be visible and expand and achieve what we hope. But if more of the filter's ahead of us, then our odds are pretty low. We should still try, but can't have too much hope.
Hi, Curt here. If you're enjoying this conversation, please take a second to like and to share this video with someone who may appreciate it. It actually makes a difference in getting these ideas out there. Subscribe, of course. Thank you. Okay, so where are the aliens?
The aliens are either nowhere, because we're the only creatures in the universe, or they're out there, but they somehow can't leave their planets. There's some obstacle that they always stay small and can't go very far. They're at our level, but never get much farther. Or they're out there, and there's a lot of them, but we can't see them because they haven't gotten here yet. So one way there could be a lot of aliens in the universe is if they expand really fast, because that means you wouldn't see them until they're almost here. So that's the basis of my grabby aliens analysis. I did this great filter analysis roughly, 25 years ago. And then in the, 5 years ago, I returned to the topic and tried to do a more numerical analysis. I had a mathematical model of the distribution of aliens in space-time with three parameters, each of which I fit to data, me and colleagues, and that can tell us where everybody is in space-time, and I think we have a fit to that model, so I can roughly tell you. So there's three key parameters. The idea is aliens appear at random places in space-time. They appear at random times, but the random time has a power law, we could explain. That is, it's more likely later in time and earlier in time. There's a constant and a power in the power law.
So you mean to say they're randomly distributed in space, but not space-time, because time has a different distribution?
Right. That is, very early, that's almost no chance they appear, and then they appear more and more rapidly as time goes on. And that's because there's a hard steps model that makes that prediction. And then once they appear, they start expanding, and there's a speed of expansion. But the interesting thing to note is they expand very fast, then you have very little chance of seeing them until they get here. That is, if they were in your backward light cone, they would be here now instead of us, and we could not have appeared. So the only way our part of space-time can be empty waiting for us is if they're not here, in which case that's a selection effect that says they could be lots of places elsewhere in space-time, but they're not right here because right. If they had been in our past, they would be here instead of us. So the aliens expanding very fast is the way there could be a lot of them. Basically, half of the universe right now could be filled with aliens, but we still couldn't see it from here because they expand so fast that you don't see them until they're almost here. So that's one way of saying, where are the aliens? They're all over, but they expand really fast, more than, say, half the speed of light, which is crazy fast.
And where are you getting that number, half the speed of light?
I get that from fitting this model to our data. So if I make a statistical model of aliens in space-time, and I try the parameter they expand slowly, what I see is that at any one time any civilization appears in the universe, when it looks out to see other alien civilizations, it sees a lot of them. But as I increase the speed of expansion, the number of other alien civilizations that they see decreases. And when they get a high enough speed, they don't see any. So that when we look out and we don't see any, then we say, aha, that's showing us the speed is very high.
Okay, so what credence do you place that the UFOs that are seen, some of them are going to be some atmospheric effect or something else that's misidentified, but that remaining percentage that the pilots and right. The government seems to think it's not of any worldly government. What credence do you assign to those as being actual aliens?
So there's two steps of a UFO analysis. In a Bayesian analysis, there's what's called a prior, your estimate of the likelihood of a scenario independent of the evidence you've seen. And secondly, there's a likelihood, which is what's the chance that this evidence you've seen would arise if this hypothesis were true. So I've looked at the concrete evidence of UFOs, and I'm not an expert on that, but my rough judgment is some of it is pretty weird and not easily dismissed. So that at least makes the likelihood not crazy, but my analysis of aliens makes me an expert on the prior. So I feel like I should speak up as an expert and say, okay, having done this analysis of grabby aliens, I am well-placed to think about what the prior should be on whether UFOs could be aliens. You'll have to combine that with the likelihood to see it, the actual thing. So as an example, on average in a murder trial, 1 in 1,000 people on average are murdered, and 1 in 1,000 associates might be the murderer. So that makes any one accusation of a murder roughly a 1 in 1,000,000 prior. But typical, a murder trial can collect sufficient evidence to overcome a 1 in 1,000,000 prior to get you to convict the accused as murder, right? So that's roughly what we're thinking about. You know, can we get the prior up to 1 in 1,000,000 or even higher here? And if in which case, you'll have to look at the evidence to make the decision. Some people want to say, this is so crazy a hypothesis you have, I don't need to look at your evidence, that's just wrong. And if the prior were, 1 in 10 to the 20, then that might be right. So the question is, how high is the prior? So basically, in order to produce a prior, what I have to try to do is construct the most plausible scenario that's consistent with what we know about the universe and them eventually showing up here as UFOs. So my analysis there, I get a prior roughly 1 in 10,000 to 1 in 1,000. and that's large enough that you should look at the evidence. It's not certain at all. If you didn't see any evidence, you would dismiss it as not likely, right? But since there is evidence, I gotta say, you should look at it because this is not a crazy prior. So would you like to go through the actual scenario?
Sure.
Okay. So when we're trying to explain UFOs as aliens, there's a couple of key features we need to explain. One is, you know, the universe around us is empty. So we're postulating that there were aliens close enough to arrive here, but they didn't go everywhere else around. So we need to explain, why aren't they everywhere else? Why are they only here if they're here and not somewhere else? Secondly, we need to explain, okay, they didn't go everywhere else, but they did come here. Why did they come here? And third, the thing they're doing here is a bit weird. So, you know, I'll phrase it as, they are not completely invisible, nor really obvious. Now, both of these would be relatively easy. So for context, almost surely if there were aliens and they had, you know, a modestly independent origin, they would be maybe, you know, 10 million, 100 million years more advanced than us. Like, it would be very unlikely they're only 1,000 years more advanced. That would be a crazy time coincidence. So you're by assumption imagining alien species that's way more advanced than us. 10 million, 100 million years. So with that level of advancedness, not only could they have easily colonized the whole galaxy or more very visibly, if they were around here, they could have been completely invisible or completely visible. Those would be just
trivial options. For them.
Right, exactly. So now we have to puzzle. They didn't choose either of those two options. They picked something sort of in the middle. They decided to hang out at the edge of our visibility, not being invisible, not being visible. That's kind of weird. And there also doesn't seem to be doing very much there, right? They didn't make a big mega city here on Earth or around Saturn or something. They're not making huge factories or construction projects. They're just kind of flitting about, not really doing anything, not interacting. And that's kind of weird, right? So I need a story that predicts that.
Or interacting seldomly.
But to little consequence, it seems, right? What's the point of coming all this way if that's what you're going to do? You know, I think this is part of the puzzle. So if you say, I need a theory that explains the UFO as alien scenario, I need a story where the UFOs, some of them are actually aliens who then came from a long way away, who are then are much older than us, who nevertheless did not colonize the galaxy, decided to come here, and then decided to hang out at this edge of visibility thing, not doing much of anything. Okay, that's my challenge if I'm going to come up with a story.
New update, started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.